First, you know Maggie Nelson. Danzy Senna is the author of 5 critically acclaimed books of fiction and nonfiction. I guess 4 critically acclaimed, 1 on its way. Not yet critically acclaimed, almost critically acclaimed. Books of fiction and nonfiction, winners of awards and accolades, translated into a dozen languages. Her novels, Caucasia and Symptomatic, which is my personal favorite, in part because it's a novel in its own right, it's also the best critical treatise on the Harlem Renaissance ever written, which I think is really interesting. It's set in present day, but nonetheless. She's written a memoir, which I think, am I talking out of school to say it was written a little bit under duress?
Published under duress.
Published under duress, and we'll talk about that a little bit. Called Where Did You Sleep Last Night? A Personal History, and a short story collection. Her new novel, New People, is coming out in early fall of this year, late summer. She's won the Whiting Awards Prize, the Dos Passos Prize, for literature, which I find to be an interesting prize, the Dos Passos Prize. That means that you get in a punching match with Hemingway, I think, at some point, right, or with the Penn Hemingway winner, maybe.
Right,
I don't know.
Right.
And then the person who's not here is Viet Nguyen. His novel, The Sympathizer, made a little bit of a splash. It was a New York Times, LA Times bestseller, won the Pulitzer Prize for Fiction, Dayton Literary Prize, Edgar Prize for First Novel, the Andrew Carnegie Medal for Excellence in Fiction, and so forth. His other books are Nothing Ever Dies, Vietnam, and The Memory of War, which was a finalist for the National Book Award in Nonfiction, and other prizes as well, and Race and Resistance, Literature and Politics in Asian America. He's the Errol Arnold Chair of English and Professor of American Studies and Ethnicity at the University of Southern California, and his current book is a short story collection called Refugees. Hector Tobar was a national and foreign correspondent for the LA Times for many years. Is the author of 2 books of fiction and 2 of nonfiction. The latest are The Barbarian Nursery, a novel, one of the great LA novels, and Deep Down Dark, The Untold Stories of 33 Men Buried in a Chilean Mine and the Miracle That Set Them Free. He, therefore, like the rest of the panel, has, in the course of moving between fiction and nonfiction, between lyric and fact, if that's a reasonable distinction, I'm not sure it is, but we'll get to that, worked through his relation to these modes. And in a piece that you wrote for the LA Review of Books blog leading up to the conference, you talk about the impact of learning after years in the discipline of hard journalism to, quote, think like an artist. And I thought maybe that would be a place to start. Okay. What does it mean to think like an artist?
Well, thank you, Tom. And to Amy and everyone else at UCI involved in inviting us here, it's a great honor. Both Danzy and I are graduates of the UCI MFA program. So it's always glad to come home. And in fact, when I came here, I was my primary experience as a writer had been as a writer of daily journalism. And that's where you try, and your mission is to go and find the truth in 5 hours before 4:45, when the city editor starts, like, you know, wrapping your knuckles and taking your story away from you. And so I was really fearful when I was first a writer. I was writing for a daily newspaper, and I just remember the absolute fear of getting a fact wrong. Because in those days, the LA Times circulation, it was printed on the front page, 1.1 million. So any mistake I made in fact would be reproduced 1.1 million times, which is terrifying. I just had some really great editors who told me that my writing was really flat, that I needed to become more bold. And so in order to sort of add more layers of truth to my writing, I started reading fiction. I remember every year I'd buy Best American Short Stories, and I just wanted to sort of learn this new method of thinking about the people that I was interviewing. I was giving this free pass to go out into Los Angeles every day. I'd go to the federal courthouse, I'd go to homeless camps, I'd go to political rallies, and I'd come back with facts for a story, but I was also being immersed in this larger story of LA, and I could tell that I wasn't I wasn't having given the freedom to tell it in the pages of the Los Angeles Times. The LA Times then, a very proud newspaper, had this tradition of objectivity, which, as I describe in this piece, I eventually understood meant that we try to offend as few people as possible. Because objectivity meant the newspaper was bipartisan in those days. It meant that Republicans and Democrats could both read it and find it a source of truth or fact or whatever. And we would, you know, and this was obviously an economic strategy for the newspaper. The newspaper was a big tent. Everybody fit in. Guys who liked NASCAR could buy the sports section. People who wanted to read, foreign news. Well, we had foreign bureaus to bring beautiful writing, beautiful prose from witnesses sent to go see civil wars in Kenya or the fall of apartheid. We had this incredible reporting. And so it was this huge tent, and we all had to sort of try to fit in it. And so objectivity was this idea that we could all fit in this one tent and there would be this one verifiable truth. But for me as a writer, it meant that some of the things that Maggie was talking about, this idea of my own notion of what was wrong with America, what was wrong with Los Angeles, I couldn't say that. In fact, that's why I quit the LA Times the first time I quit. Was after the LA riots, because I felt I was a writer and a witness and I knew why the city had burned in 1992 and I wasn't allowed to tell that story. So in order to tell that story, I wrote a novel. I made up stories that had truths in them. And so for me, learning to be an artist meant, for me personally, it meant getting in touch with my ability to express emotionality, my ability to express the textures of the things that I was witnessing, my ability to sort of talk about history. You know, my first novel is a really angry novel about fascism in Central America and homelessness in LA, and just having the freedom to invent characters that illustrated these truths. LA is an imperial city. LA is part of this empire of inequality. You know, that was the message of my first novel. And so being able to say that required me to become an artist, and it liberated me. And then later it made me a better journalist, because when I became a journalist, I understood there were places I could go in telling nonfiction that I wouldn't have gone otherwise. And so that's what I meant by becoming an artist.
And Danzy, you went the opposite direction. You started as a novelist, and then you wrote your first nonfiction book. Was there a...
And last. I came to Irvine, to this program, many years ago with a first chapter of a novel, and I'd been working in magazines, actually, and it was very close to my own life story. It was set in Boston in the civil rights movement, and like me, the protagonist was the child of a black man and a white woman who were political activists, and she had a sister who was more visibly African-American than she was, and she could, quote, pass. And there was a little brother, and the mother was small, like my mother, and nervous. And when I got to the program, I found myself very stuck with this story that was hopefully the beginning of a novel. And I kept coming up against the feeling of feeling hemmed in by my own autobiography. Wow. And loyal to the people I was writing about rather than loyal to the story I was trying to tell. And the moment I made the mother in the story much bigger than my mother, physically, heavier, and the moment I started to make her speak differently from my mother, the moment I took out the brother, and in other words, the moment I began to lie, the story started to have a kind of internal propulsion, and I felt liberated to fully imagine this story on the page. And it was the moment it became not me that the story really took off. And it was also the moment that my peers in the workshop started to say, you know, I know this has to be completely true because it reads so true. And it was only the moment that I started to make it up. And then I began to lie more, and I decided I had grown up in Boston with both my parents in the black and the white worlds, and my sister sharing a bedroom with her forever. And the moment I had those two sisters be separated, the story began to become more and more true in some way. The emotion of the story began to feel true to me, and these characters began to seem more real than anything else. But what was interesting was then I finished this novel, and the thing I was most proud about was that it was fiction and that I had turned it into something other than myself. And the moment I tried to sell it to the publishing world, and I did sell it, my editor began to say, well, we want to put in your publicity materials that you also are half black and half white, and that you also are the child of a civil rights activist. And can we just put that in your author profile? And can you talk about how this story reflects your own life? And I found myself on this book tour defending the act of being an artist and the act of being a fiction writer. And throughout all of my books, I've noticed that as a writer of color and as a woman writer, you become, and it's very easy to fall into the trap of becoming the subject of your own work and becoming the specimen there to reflect the autobiographical elements in your own work. And it's very hard to take on that authority of being an author and then having constructed something. And so the thing I realize, I'm really interested in this act of taking one's own life and then departing from it. And why is that such a liberating thing for me as a writer? The moment I begin to lie is the moment the story begins to become something real to me. It's the moment of lying. And I think that I look for the story that didn't happen within the story that did, and that is always the kernel of my writing. I did write a memoir, and I found that I had to use a lot of the same techniques as fiction writing in my memoir, in that the story really doesn't take off until you have a persona and a voice and until you become sort of a construct on the page to yourself. And also the moment you start to leave things out. The story is not interesting if you put everything in there. That you have to start leaving white space and allowing for this sort of, the picture isn't interesting unless you have white space around it, and only then does it become a picture. So the act of writing memoir, I also would say, is an act of constructing something. And if my siblings were to write a memoir about the same thing, it would be a very different story, obviously.
So I'm just going to stop there
and give this to Maggie.
Oh, okay. It's coming down. Are we all going to address the same, same thing or whatever? No, okay.
Yeah, we'll respond to what you
did. I feel locked in my movement. I think it's really interesting. I think it's interesting what you're saying, Danzy, and what you're saying about like moments in which your writer becomes hemmed in or locked in or needs to change or grow and or finds some way of how the work feels more possible. And I think that I think that not you guys, but in general, if you listen to a lot of writers or artists or whoever in the world, people will often fall into this trap of kind of, you guys didn't do this, I swear to God, you didn't. But like, that we can aggrandize what we've found to do and be like, therefore, fiction tells greater truths. Like, you can extrapolate from it instead of being kind of like, I found this was the way for me that to move things forward. So I think you can kind of tell in the keynote, like I tend to like to kind of take several steps back from things and kind of try and analyze in a more macro sense what I see going on. And I think in that way that, I've always been very interested coming from the world of poetry in the way that nobody has these kind of Ernestine warfare conversations about whether or not your poetry is true. It's like true in an autobiographical sense. And it's, again, like I was saying about the autobiographical pact. I mean, to me, it's because the pact of poetry is not a pact that has veracity as part of its initial offering, right? So that, like, there is a premise to the genre, and the premise is not that the poetic speaker you know, that Keats really did hold out his living hand, or that, you know, like, or that we don't think Langston Hughes necessarily was sitting on that stoop saying X. Like, it's not, it's just not one-to-one like that. So I think in that way, coming from that to working in criticism and autobiography, to me, I mean, to me, I'm a huge kind of scholar and fan and practitioner of autobiography as art. I don't, like Danzy was saying, I don't, this kind of idea that, like, writing autobiographically is letting it all hang out is a complete, it's just not, if you've ever done it, you just learn very quickly, as you're saying, that's not what the art is. And, you know, I think once in my life I let a publisher use the word memoir, sadly, for a book that thankfully I got to rename last year. It was called The Red Parts. Simon & Schuster made it a memoir, but now it's out with a new title called The Autobiography of a Trial, which I think is more interesting. But I think, to my mind, I've never titled any of my autobiographical books. I've titled them things like Bluettes or like The Argonauts. Like, they don't indicate they're. It's, to me, it's a tradition that I call kind of after the French, like life writing, and it doesn't. Life writing doesn't offer itself. It doesn't have as it's packed, whether it's autofiction, to a very stringent nonfiction. You can be kind of anywhere on that line. I was gonna talk earlier, probably a lot of you know that Janet Malcolm, very famous piece in The Journalist and the Murderer, I think, unless it's in a different book, but you know, where she's talking about nonfiction is like rearranging, being a renter where you get to rearrange the furniture, and fiction is like you get to build the house, you know. And I think as a renter, and maybe now a, you know, deeply ambivalent homeowner, but like I'm much happier as a renter, I've noticed, and that I think that to me, the aporias and the limitations and the stringencies of fact in life writing are where I find the opportunity to the writing to come alive, because I'm very interested in what you do when you hit something that you don't know. Some people invent, or some people like Siebel do kind of a blur. In my mind, I kind of try to make space, I guess, for the thing that's not known. So I think it's a real opportunity for creation and invention, and not a limitation.
You can keep the mic. Okay. I'll shout the question. One more prompt, and then we're going to ask you for your questions. We're in an academic setting. We all teach somewhere, somewhere or other. My very first job was as an instructor at Stanford, where I was teaching in a what we called a multicultural Plato to NATO course. You know, a Western culture course, and. And it was, and at one point, and I was a young radical, and I was teaching Foucault, and I thought I was doing the good, you know, radical lefty work of explaining to these students that truth is just, as Foucault says, the interpretation of whoever happens to be in power. And one of my students, this young guy, said, and this will date it perfectly. He said, "Key, dude," he said, "I'm going to be in power.
Right.
Whatever I think is going to be the truth." And so I'm wondering, and I know, Maggie, you've written a fair amount about this, about the relationship between theory as the general movement of, you know, cultural and literary theory, general movement in our disciplines for the last 20, 30 years, and its relation to the moment of truth that we're in at the moment.
Well, I'll just say that, you know, in what I read to you guys, it seems a little too narrow to perseverate on, but I am interested in this, you know, article where Kakutani is talking about, you know, comparing phrase creative nonfiction alterations in his story to the invention of, you know, uranium rods presented by Colin Powell or whatever to justify the, you know, and kind of this and blaming this, you know, this. You know, relativism, and you know, now we're kind of, seems like we often get bogged down into a fight of like, you know, who started this propaganda thing? Was it, you know, lefties and, you know, relativists and postmodernists and identity politic people who happen to be whiter people, you know, people of color, women or queers, or is it like, you know, did this begin, you know, in the more, you know, are we talking about power and we're talking about the fact that propaganda is very old, and we're talking about, I mean, and I think that whether or not Foucault was kind of diagnosing a situation is distinct from, you know, Foucault taught people how to navigate through situations. He didn't try and say how it is, per se. It was a kind of, I'm losing my thought, but the point is that I think that there are a lot of, as I was pointing out about Sotomayor, there, I don't think of, like, all relativisms are not one, you know, the notion of subjectivity is not an excuse for rampant lying. I mean, these are not, like, distinctions need to be made, and I don't think that, as I said in my talk, that, you know, we don't get anywhere by smearing out the clarity between these categories.
Yeah, I think I started out writing for a magazine, sort of writing for Newsweek. It wasn't really writing, but and then, you know, moved into fiction. But I was a political activist at Stanford too, and my whole life I had struggled with all these questions around race and identity, identity politics, and at Stanford getting arrested and changing the curriculum to make you teach classes like, you know, force them to have required classes that were more multicultural. But when I, you know, I'd say when I first read Nella Larsen and some of the writers that I read, James Baldwin, I found a home in story and in fiction, and I realized that was the language I felt most at home with to explore these very questions. And I liked the idea of there being more questions at the end of writing than answers. And so it felt more honest to me to think through story. And I found myself, like, and that was just my comfort zone. That just really spoke to me and allowed for all the complexity and contradictions that I was witnessing to exist, that a kind of political writing didn't, overtly political writing, didn't allow for those gray areas for me, though I think it can. It was not the way I was able to think through these questions.
I think I remember seeing or a study somewhere that when people read prose, narratives, they experience the reading of it as if it were true, right, in their brains. There's some reaction in our brains. You're reading Gulliver's Travels, or you're reading, you know, a Don DeLillo novel, or you're reading Truman Capote, and you're in Kansas, or you're in some weird place in New York, and you really feel it, you know? And I think that that the ability to do that is what we aim for in our craft, is to create this illusion of a lived experience, right? Not true or factual, but a lived experience that we can relate to. And so in journalism, you do that by interviewing people, gathering facts. And the most important thing that I teach, we're talking about teaching, when I teach creative nonfiction, is empathy. It's you become another person when you interview them. You surrender your prejudices, you open yourself up so that someone can reveal what they, the truths that they have to tell you. And that is a human connection. To me, that's where the power of any kind of writing comes from. I wrote a novel, The Barbarian Nurseries, and it reminds me, you were talking about, you know, the same process of when it was a lie, it became more powerful to you and more true to you. I wrote The Barbarian Nurseries from the perspective of a woman. It's, you know, it's a novel written from the point of view of a Mexican woman. I'm not either Mexican or a woman. And so I felt incredibly transgressive. But it allowed me to get into this dream space of the real with her and to become, and to take charge of it as a storyteller, you know, because it's really smoke and mirrors writing, you know. There's an element of a sleight of hand, mm-hmm. you know. In journalism, you spend 2 or 3 days talking to someone, right? And I tell my students the illusion that you're trying to aim for at the end is that you knew everything about them, that you were God. In fact, in the reporting, sometimes I say, you know, you've done all this reporting, you've been working on the story for 2 weeks. If you were God and could find out one fact to make this story work just perfectly, what would it be? And people, well, if I knew what his mother was thinking, well, go try and find his mother so you can interview her, you know. And so the power of writing comes from losing yourself deeper into human experience. And that's something that I think I have found is common to both journalism and to fiction, to novel writing. And the trick in journalism is to teach that and also remind people that they will eventually be, there is an accounting, which is that people may read about themselves. Mm-hmm. So I wrote this book about the Chilean miners, 33 guys trapped in a mine. I always knew that they would read it one day. So I really couldn't take complete liberties. And, you know, so that's nonfiction has that.
Right.
You know, I couldn't invent, you know, a devil. I didn't have to. Somebody said he had seen the devil. But, you know, I couldn't invent things. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, learning to sort of move back and forth, I just feel that in the end, really what makes something work, which is really what we're concerned about, is that it feels like something that could have happened, something that's not outside of our human experience.
I have a feeling that, Maggie, you agreed with parts of that as Hector was saying, and not all of it, but maybe we should open it up to the general room first. I think you came out in the same place, but on a very different kind of path. But let's take questions.
I got into a lot of trouble when I wrote nonfiction involving them. I haven't gotten into trouble with my fiction, I think, because I go through that process of turning it into a kind of composite, and half of my imagination and half is stolen from a variety of people. And by the time you finish that 10th draft, it really isn't, you know, the sources of the autobiography become less and less clear. But but it's interesting, I mean, when you write nonfiction, and I'm sure Maggie can speak to this as well, about people you're intimately involved with and families, you do, you know, I don't encourage my students and say, you know, you must go and you have the right to tell this story, because you have to think about what you can handle.
Yay.
In terms of the fallout, you really have to think about what it is you, and sometimes you decide to tell a story that you have lived, and what you remember, despite what people want you to say, and the price of not telling that story may be higher than the price of telling it, and that's really a personal decision. And Maggie, do you want to say anything?
Oh, I mean, I think it's a perennial question working in nonfiction. It probably isn't one I think, if I'm, as I say elsewhere, in drag as a memoir, it's probably the one I get asked the most often. I think that, actually, in my book, The Argonauts, I say that when faced with it, you know, I often feel like people either want blanket permission, which one can't give, you know, or they want to be guaranteed against bad consequences, which you also can't give. I think you can... I mean, to me, nonfiction writing, maybe I was curious when you were saying about knowing that the miners were going to read it, you know, again, part of that pact when you're writing with people that you know or that you know might read the work is that it's an invitation into ethics, basically. It's an invitation into ethical relations. So you have to make your own decisions within that, and there's nobody that can make those decisions for you because nobody makes our ethical decisions for us, you know, in that way. So I think in that way you, for some people, it's, you know, slash and burn, like, I have this to say, and it outweighs and anything else, I'm going to say it, you know. But, you know, there, of course, are consequences, and they have to be dealt with. I mean, in any given work... I've learned nothing from writing many books of nonfiction about living people, save that every single time and in every single case, it's different. And it has to be addressed distinctly, you know.
Yeah, to me, you know, you mentioned this miner's book that I did. There was something really kind of unethical at the heart of the project, which is that I was a therapist to these wounded men, mm-hmm. who opened themselves up to me, and then I said everything they told me. Mm-hmm. You know, and I've been in therapy, you know, it's this sort of, there's confidentiality involved, you know, and you open up. And so I had guys tell me almost very, very rarely would they not tell me something when I asked them a question. Mm-hmm. And they revealed all these really painful things. And when I sat down to write, I was utterly ruthless, mm-hmm. you know. I just needed to sort of get the story exactly as it was, as I could best sort of imagine it to be, being trapped in this mine. And so, you know, I haven't had anybody tell me, you know, and in fact, there different things can happen. People can feel you've revealed something about them, but also people can feel powerful because, you know, we've worked on our craft. You know, we've spent years finding the secret that can make a whole room of people want to read our books. So we've made ourselves powerful that way. And so it's like giving somebody a megaphone. You make them, in a certain sense, you're aiming to give them immortality. And people, people can often like that feeling of just becoming eternal. You know, that's what I told the miners when I interviewed them for the first time. I said, you guys have lived the great adventure of the beginning of the 21st century. You're like Odysseus who's come back from Troy, and my job is to be your Homer. I didn't ever get really much response to that, but that was the idea. That's what I was trying to do.
I think I understood the gist of the question from the answers.
Yeah.
I apologize to everybody for being late. Everything that possibly could have gone wrong went wrong this day. I always go back to the first line of Maxine Hong Kingston's The Woman Warrior, which is, "You must not tell anyone, my mother said, what I am about to tell you," which is exactly what she proceeds to do. And actually, in the very first sentence, the injunction is laid down, and then the trespass is laid down as well. And of course, you know, I certainly do believe that one of the tasks that writers have, fiction or nonfiction, is to tell what must not be told and say what must not be said. And sometimes that takes place on a very individual level, right? That level of the truth-telling as a form of personal betrayal to your family or to some individual. But also, it's a matter of saying what must not be said within a larger context as well. So I wrote The Sympathizer as a novel that could pretend to be nonfiction. And because it could pretend to be nonfiction, it allowed me to say lots of big nonfictional things that generally in American literature, contemporary American literature, you're not supposed to say, you know, because you're not supposed to tell, you're only supposed to show, but I wanted to tell. And by using nonfiction, I could do that and, you know, say certain things about American culture or about Vietnamese politics or communism or about the South Vietnamese that these communities typically didn't want to hear.
Right.
So as I've said it repeatedly, I want to defend everybody, and I did my best to do that. And then lastly, as an academic, I think within academic genres and academic constraints, there are also certain things that you're not supposed to say. There are boundaries within academia. We all know that. And there's conventions. And if you break, academics are very conventional.
Yeah.
You know, you don't want to disturb them too much. They get very nervous if you write in a way you're not supposed to write. And so that's what I also try to do in my nonfiction work too, is to, you know, I did the reverse. I try to write emotionally and subjectively in my critical work. You're not supposed to do that in academia because you're supposed to be such an objective, rational individual, and that's such a pretense. If you've ever been in an English department meeting, you know it's a pretense. These are not objective, rational people. I offend people. Sorry.
Okay, other questions?
He doesn't even know.
other questions?
What's interesting for me in terms of time passing is that I grew up in Boston at a period before there was a multiracial category or option, and I say like pre-Tiger Woods. I grew up, you know, where you were either black or you were white if you're mixed, and my parents being very politicized and kind of aware of the intense kind of blatant racism around us, understood that the identity that needed protecting was our black identity. And that was the identity that was under threat. And all three of us also looked like, you know, quote unquote, looked like we were a different race. And so everyone thought we were Puerto Rican, basically. Like, if you all look a different race than your Puerto Rican siblings. And so they kind of didn't want to separate us. And the only identity which kind of incorporates every shade is black identity in this context. So you know, my father grew up in the Deep South. And you know, blackness looked like me, and blackness looked very different from me. And so, you know, when I've traveled to Louisiana with him, where he was born, it's like, it's not a strange thing to say that I'm black. But throughout the course of my life, this changed, and I watched it change. And so I feel like, you know, the last of the one droppers or something. Like, I was raised as a black woman and became a mixed woman and saw that option open up. And and my work, I see myself, my work in relation to African American literature, because I see it as African American identity as a mixed identity and a identity that incorporates all these parts of myself. But I think, you know, everybody has their own personal journey and context in which they're born that informs them, and we're all a product of the history and the moment that we're born. So, yes.
I'll jump in because the character, the narrator, the sympathizer is half French and half Vietnamese, and I deliberately did that in order to address the very problem that you're talking about. And in general, I think the larger problem is that this is a false binary, right? You have to choose one side or the other. But we're always being offered false binaries. And power is always going to want to give us a choice. Choose A or B, when either choice actually makes you complicit with the power structure. In this case, you're talking about racial identification, right? So I think one of the most difficult things to do is to be able to even identify when you're being given a false choice. And I'll use one very classic example. Are you a minority writer or are you a writer? That's a false choice, right? You have to be able to figure out why that's a false choice and make it explicit. And that unfortunately puts the burden of explaining the context on you as the individual. So there's no simple answer. So let me give you a 5-minute lecture on why that's a false choice before I give you the actual answer. So there is no easy solution to that, right? But except to refuse to answer the question in its own terms.
I think that I start off when I'm interviewing someone and when I'm teaching interviewing, which is also to me like the process of writing in lots of ways. I tell my students that interviewing is writing with questions. So when you meet somebody, find out where they want to go on a journey and lose yourself with them. And, you know, it's then a process of just trying to understand and make it as real as possible. And, you know, when I interview somebody, I am finding out where they want to take me, but also the textures of the world they live in. And I like to tell my students that in all the years I've interviewed people, I've interviewed maybe 10,000 people, there's really only one person I didn't like. It was a Hungarian Nazi. I hated him. But everybody else, you know, Republicans, Libertarians, I always found some point of identification with the person, you know? And then when I wrote my novel, The Barbarian Nurseries, I found out I could become all these different people. I switched the point of view 100 times. And it was all about respecting each character. This is something that I learned as a novelist when I had a novel that didn't sell. I wrote a novel that was set in Orange County about an immigrant woman who's charged with a crime, and I had her antagonist with these two, this white couple. My novel never sold. It was rejected by 25 publishers, and I let it sit for like 5, 6, 7 years, and I picked it up one day after writing another book, a book of nonfiction, and I realized the reason it didn't sell was because it sucked. And the reason it sucked was because the couple, the antagonists, were not real people. They were like constructions of mine, ideological constructions. They were the antagonists. And I learned a really important lesson, which is that you have to respect every character on the page. They have to have integrity. Whether they're fictional or non-fictional people. And that takes a lot of work. So to me, if you're, I have more and more faith in my readers as I get older. I have more faith that I can take them into more complicated emotional, complicated political places, as long as I respect the integrity of the people who populate my stories.
I actually don't think about my reader because I have to live for so many years with these novels that I better be amused or interested in what I'm writing. I have to be my first reader. Right. And later the sort of critical voice comes in that's not really the critic from the New York Times. It's you know, I have to step back through stages and start to see if this story holds up and if it works. But I'm constantly trying to get to that space where I'm reading the book I want to write, and I'm writing the book I want to read. And for me personally, because I come from such a sort of political activist background, I actually have to kick those voices out of the room as well, and I can't be beholden to bell hooks or some, you know, someone. She can't be in the room with me either.
I
have to.
I just
to,
feel that, especially when it's a first-person narrator or the actual first person in autobiographical, it feels like it's expressing itself to a reader.
Well,
I think, oh, go ahead.
Okay, go ahead.
Well, I think you can have the feeling or the motion of expression while caring actually zilch zero for an actual reader. And I would say that's how I write a lot, is very smitten with the feeling of address and of thought and of thinking aloud in public, which presumes that you're thinking aloud, not necessarily at the edge of the Grand Canyon, right? But I think absolutely zero about any individual person at all. And I think it's, you know, only when something is completely finished that I will allow myself to then go through the process of imagining how it might hit the world, or if I might want to change things.
Publication.
Publication, which is completely distinct from writing altogether, you know.
Well, no, I don't disagree with that, what anybody has said. I think that when I wrote The Sympathizer, I wrote it for me. Psychologically, that was a trick, you know, because it wasn't really real that I wrote it for me. I mean, I wrote it for me as I was writing it, but every time my agent called, I was like, oh my God, I'm writing for my agent too. You know, because I knew, in reality, like, okay, I would write it for myself, but then at a certain point, once it was finished, other people would read it. Editors, agents, all that kind of stuff, right? But I had to trick myself psychologically to think, I'm not going to do that. Because when I wrote my short stories, I was worried about editors and agents and publishers, even if I thought I was writing for myself, and that was really debilitating. But even if we tell ourselves that we're writing for ourselves, I'm wondering if there isn't always, if we have to be also aware of implied readers. Because I, as a critic, you know, I diagnose bodies of literature, and so I diagnose so-called ethnic literature and Asian American literature. And to me, it seems that, I don't know who these authors are writing their books for, but it seems that they're oftentimes writing for white people.
Right.
How do you get into this mindset where you think you're writing to yourself, but you end up actually writing for white people? So you have to actually be aware that this could actually be happening in order to prevent it from happening. So I was very aware that of that possibility, and I thought, I'm going to deliberately write this book towards Vietnamese people. And once you make that decision, you make certain formal decisions that you wouldn't make before. So I've said it often, if you know that you're writing to someone of your own community or to someone who knows what you're talking about, you don't have to translate. Yeah. But if you think you're writing for white people or whoever the dominant population is or some population that's different from you in some crucial way, you're going to translate. And you're not even going to know you're translating, because the ingrained habit of speaking to dominant power is a reflexive action that you're not even aware of, right?
Right.
And that goes back to this question of the binaries. You know, once you've taken power into yourself and normalized it, you don't even know that you're responding to power. So that's a crucial step, is to even identify that reflex taking place.
Right, and that's, I think, if I could just, one thing, that's what art does. Art breaks these barriers. It breaks these ways of thinking. I mean, I know as a Latino writer, I always felt the need to translate my Spanish. I'd write Spanish, and I'd find a way indirectly of translating it, until my white editor, Sean McDonald, told me, stop doing that. That's like not, you know, it's just not helping. And he was also Juno Diaz's editor, and I had the experience of Juno Diaz, who blew up my linguistic world and told me, you can do anything you want, dude. And so that's what I feel part of the responsibility of art is. A lot of writers of color are writing to what they think will sell. They're writing to the marketplace. It's not so much they're writing to white people, they're writing to the marketplace. And I, you know, it just leads to bad art.
I agree. You know, I thought I was writing to myself, but of course, I've been in the United States for 40 years, living in the same academic structure that you live in, presumably, so maybe it's not a surprise that speaking to myself is speaking to someone of a fairly similar habitus, but... you know, I read a lot of great novels. I've read a lot of great novels in my life just because I like them, and I read a lot of great novels in preparation
for writing writing this book, including rereading Portnoy's Complaint. I'd read Portnoy's Complaint when I was 12 or 13, and all I remembered 30 years later was the liver scene.
Yeah.
Right, yeah.
And it became squid,
yeah. I also have read a lot of bad and mediocre novels, and that's actually really important too. Especially if you're a professional critic. If you're a professional critic, you have to read a lot of stuff that you don't want to read because it falls under your purview for whatever reason. And even though that's kind of a chore, it's actually really helpful because then you get to see how entire genres operate and what the tics are and these reflexes and these trends. And the novel is very deliberately a refusal to write in these patterns, right? Mm-hmm. So it's both an aspiration to write like Roth or Celine or whomever I was aspiring to model myself after, but it was also a deliberate rejection of Vietnam War cliches, of Asian American literary cliches, of Vietnamese American literary cliches. So whoever you are as a writer, you know, you have to know the traditions that you're immersed in and that you're responding to, so that you both know what the pinnacles are. You want to, you know, write like Toni Morrison, but you also want to know like what all the average writers are doing too, so that you can aspire to be different and better than that.
I think it's definitely not a fascist value. I think I can say that with pretty much certainty. Empathy is not a fascist value. But I, you know, for me, empathy does not mean I surrender my authorial voice to my subject. It doesn't mean that I excuse them. It doesn't mean that I don't write things that are embarrassing to them. It means that I try to understand, I try to cross the barrier between us so that I can come back and betray them if I have to. You know, I mean, so it's not, for me, it's not, I mean, there's a lot of really bad journalism, bad literature in which, you know, for me, the cliches of Latino literature are the passive, you know, peasant, the simple-minded person, and so the author, the white author has, and there's countless books like this, I won't name any of them, you know, has this incredible sympathy and empathy for this person who they're writing about, and yet portrays them in this incredibly one-dimensional way. So to me, that is, well, maybe not liberal, but it's unsatisfying in the way some people think liberalism is unsatisfying. You know, it's like, no, I'll leave it to the other colleagues.
I mean, I'll just say quickly that I totally get what we're saying about empathy, but I also really appreciate work that is very cold,
yes,
and ruthless. And I just reread Evelyn Waugh, A Handful of Dust, and that kind of lacerating satirical wit, you know, that sees things in a really cold way. That to me is also valuable, and I aspire to that as well. And I think often with women writers, you're told you have to write sympathetic female protagonists, and your work has to, you know, it has to be a protagonist that people want to hang out with. And what if you want to write a really fucked up woman character who's not nice? And I only require that she be interesting, not that she be sympathetic.
We could probably be here for a long time talking about empathy, and I think that maybe hearing your question that, you know, we're also at a cultural moment, which I think is, you know, there's that big book against empathy out right now, and there's another, I know, two other books on empathy coming out, and then I actually think it's a kind of mainstream moment for ideas that, as is often the case, have been circulating in academic circles for quite some time, if not, you know, I mean, at least for, you know, maybe 50 years or something, and Judith Butler most recently in her readings of Levinas and other notions of whether or not ethics is really found by identification or empathy, or whether or not there are forms of behaving ethically that have a more, that don't need to be, you know, substitute relatability for ethical action. And I think that, you know, we could talk about a lot of that, but because you introduced yourself as a journalist vis-a-vis immigration, I do think that there's, you know, real concerns and real value in talking about whether or not this kind of, you know,
you know, imagine yourself as that Syrian refugee, you know, that really is, that has to be at the heart of how we make humane policy. And I think that those conversations are important. You know.
I don't think empathy is a liberal value, but I think the expansion of empathy is a liberal value. So if you listen to Donald Trump, I mean, he is actually saying he's empathetic. He's saying to the people who voted for him, you will never be forgotten again, right? So there is empathy there, but it's a constricted empathy, right? And but it's important to recognize that he is projecting that empathy to an intended audience, and that that intended audience feels that they have not been empathized with, and that they want to empathize with a certain kind of a population. Mm. So there's a distinction between that kind of a political project and a political project that wants to draw a circle around the near and the dear, and the political project that wants to extend that circle out to the far and the feared. Right? Mm. But the drawback to that, I mean, there's because at least a couple of drawbacks to that, is that in our desire to empathize with a Syrian refugee, which I completely agree with, it does mean that we may not be capable of empathizing with our own political opponents. That's one issue. And the other one is that empathy itself has limited political value. Empathy is not action. Empathy is feeling. And it doesn't really matter whether we feel empathy for the Syrian refugee if we're not going to do anything about it. And that is supposedly a liberal trait, to not do anything about what you care about, right? And so there is a dilemma there about how to take action once you have empathy. It's an issue of ethical, you know, what is it, how do we take ethical action after we've identified something through empathy? And that's another question altogether.
Okay, thank you very much. That's a
perfect. Just because I love Wittgenstein so much, I just thought I might take a stab at this. But like, I mean, in that same book, The Art of Cruelty, there's a chapter called "Who We Are," and it circulates around this, you know, different thought systems that insist that who we really are is benevolent at heart. You know, who we really are is mean spirited and evil and power hungry at heart. You know, but this kind of this that there's some violence in the notion that you boil a human being down to what we really are. You know, and I think that at the end of that chapter, I quote a Buddhist teacher speaking with a student, and when you know, and she's kind of just can't stop wondering who she really is or what really is at the base of her. And he says, why don't you stop thinking about it? And the answer, and that's the answer to the problem in some sense, is kind of like, again, but action, well, you know, who cares? Move on and let's do some things that you believe in a certain way. So I think in that sense, you know, part of what I was getting at in the part of my talk about truth and art being an itinerant feeling is that that is because you know, I was tying it to Christian theology per se, but that this idea that there is going to be a reveal, you know, and that we get to a judgment day where we really see how things are, when the veil is removed, I think has been catastrophic, frankly. I'm not saying that in a, you know, anti-religious way. I just think it's I think it can be cover for all kinds of action, which is why Wittgenstein was so intent on this kind of pulling the, you know, rung out from the ladder as he climbed it, as he described philosophy, or he also said it was like, you know, getting a fly out of a fly bottle, but working on clarification rather than kind of obfuscations with moralism at their heart.
I actually wouldn't mind taking a stab at that one.
You know, I wrote a book a few years ago about American literature. It was my kind of mid-career The Function of Criticism at the Present Time book, and what I was really concerned with was the way all of the great novels, and for me, the novel is the queen of the sciences. It's the most sophisticated form of human understanding ever developed, and I think that one of the reasons is because the great novels always end with all of their fundamental problems in essential tension, without resolving to a truth. Novelistic truth is a truth that contains the opposites, that contains the two sides, right? That contains the seven kinds of ambiguity, to bring it back to an older critic. So that's my little manifesto.
It's a
great size. All-time great size.
Because the strangest example has flew into my mind, but that's what happens on the panel, so I'll just say it. But I don't know if you know this book by Natalie Angier called Woman, you know, in this book. But you know, she's an evolutionary biologist, which is, you know, a sphere that is contentious about who we are, if there ever was one. But, you know, in the opening, she just has, a very succinct description of what she thinks, because her book looks at, say, you know, what would happen if we use bonobos as a, you know, as a template for human behavior rather than the chimpanzee. You know, what would happen if we, you know, we would not be always like, it's always patriarchal or whatever, you know, or like she does, you know, they've done some really interesting research with chimps about, you know, when they have like hidden cameras and stuff that, like, you know, the patriarchy's not holding when the cameras are on, like the, all kinds of things are going on. So, but I think that her introduction there is just very, as a scientist, she's saying, I'm a feminist. I do go looking for things in the animal world as I am an evolutionary biologist that I think might serve the causes of more human equality for men and women and everyone in between. And I state that up front as part of my, that's, you know, one of the things that I'm interested in when I go to do science, you know. And I think it doesn't mean that she falsifies research. It doesn't mean that she, it means that she looks other places and is willing to take other templates as possibility. I mean, Judith Butler has talked a lot about, you know, what if we had used Antigone instead of, you know, Oedipus as a foundational myth of psychoanalysts. Like, you know, why not? Like, just think about it. You know, disobedience in the face of, the, you know, the patriarch Creon. Like, it's a different model, right? Like, so there's no, you know, we have the capacity to change frames and to admit that we're doing so and to name the reasons why we do so without, like I say, falsifying information. That seems critical to me.
That seems like a great place to end, doesn't it? Thank Viet Nguyen, Hector Tobar, Danzy Senna, Maggie Nelson.